call this meeting of the Conroe Independent School District Board of Trustees to order. Let a record show that a quorum of members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with Texas Open Meeting Act, Texas Government Code, Chapter 551. The time is now 6 o'clock. Please join me. We're going to stand. Mr. Husbands is going to lead us in the invocation.
You bow your head with me as I pray. Dear wise and loving Father, thank you on behalf of all who are gathered here today. Thank you for many and abundant blessings. Thank you for life itself, for the measure of health we need to fulfill our callings, for sustenance, and for friendship. Thank you for our ability to be involved in the useful work, for the honor of bearing appropriate responsibilities for this school district. Thanks as well for the freedom to embrace you or the freedom to reject you. Thank you for loving us even so, from your boundless and gracious nature. In the scriptures, you have said that citizens ought to obey the governing authorities, since you have established those very authorities to promote peace, order, and justice. Therefore, I pray for our district and in particular for this assembled board. And I'm asking that you would graciously grant us wisdom to govern amid the conflicting interests and issues of our times, a sense of welfare and true needs of our students, a keen thirst for justice, rightness, and kindness, confidence in what is good and fitting, the ability to work together in harmony, even when there is honest disagreement, and personal peace in our lives and joy in our tasks. I pray for the agenda set before us today. Please give us the assurance of what would please you and what would benefit those who learn, teach, and live in and around our district. It is in your most blessed name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. We actually have the presentation of colors tonight from Caney Creek High School. Mr. Moore will lead us in the pledge afterwards. But right here we have left rifle cadet chief petty officer Alvazo, right rifle cadet chief petty officer Wolf, American flag cadet chief petty officer Rodriguez, Texas flag cadet ensign Rodriguez, and their instructor is Lieutenant Commander Cortez.
Left base, trees and colors.
Please join me in the pledge to the American flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, and indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the Texas flag.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Colors. Ready. Cut. Right. Face. Forward. March.
Thank you. You may be seated. Item 2A on our agenda, special district recognition, CISD National Merit Scholarship Student Recognitions. Dr. Stockton.
We're excited tonight to have so many students to recognize. I'm going to start off with asking Mr. Caker to come up to introduce our first recipients.
Thank you, Dr. Stockton. Good evening, President Bush, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. It's my honor this evening to recognize the fine group of young men and women and celebrate their significant academic accomplishments. Tonight, we are celebrating seniors who have been recognized for their performance on the PSAT that was taken in October of their junior year. Before we introduce our honorees, I'd like to thank those who have helped them reach this point. We would like to thank our high school campus administrators and staff. If we could please have you stand at this time. I know we've got some principals here. By By offering a rigorous and varied curriculum, our campuses do an outstanding job of preparing our students to be successful. Thank you to our great teachers and administrators for their fine work. While we are extremely proud of the efforts of our campuses, we understand that the journey of these high-achieving students starts at home. Will parents, grandparents, and guardians of these students please stand to be honored at this time? The National Merit Scholarship Program is an academic competition for recognition and scholarship that began in 1955. Of the approximately 1.5 million entrants into the competition each year, about 16,000 students are notified that they have qualified as a National Merit Semifinalist. These National Merit Semifinalists represent the top 1% of scores in their respective states. It should be noted that the state of Texas has the eighth highest qualifying score in the nation, making this accomplishment for these young men and women even more impressive. It is my pleasure to introduce Denise Cipolla at this time, our Coordinator of Guidance and Counseling, to announce the names of our National Merit semifinalists. Denise.
Lane Barron, David Sow, Victoria Cottrell, Jacob Davis, Stephanie Du. Josephine Harris, Christopher Hatch, Christopher Hurd, Eric Imhoff, Kenneth Kessinger, Isabella Lee, Evan Lee, Lilia Lee, Jonathan Lowe, Samuel Packer, Clark Poon, Connor Powers, Sreya Raman,
freezing up, locking up.
Sanjana Ramchandran. Shane Reese, Vishnu Sajit, Indiana Sanicer, Oluwatobi Suarez, Min Yang Yuan.
Very quickly, on behalf of the board, you're in the top 1%. That's the elite of the elite. I don't think it gets much better than that. I just want to say on behalf of the board, congratulations to each and every one of you. You are fine students, and we're very proud of you being a part of Conroe ISD. Congratulations.
Follow them around.
There you go. Good job.
Congratulations.
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 Congratulations. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
I like that Aggie shirt.
Congratulations.
Congratulations again.
Congratulations.
Congratulations again.
Congratulations.
Congratulations again to you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations to you.
Well done.
Good luck to you.
Congratulations.
Good luck to you.
Congratulations.
Good luck to you.
Congratulations.
Best of luck to you.
Congratulations.
Best of luck to you as well.
Congratulations.
Best of luck to you. Best of luck to you.
Congratulations.
Best of luck to you.
We'll get them.
Best of luck.
Congratulations.
Coach, good to see you. Getting to be a dad.
Item 2B, Special District Recognition 2017 UIL 6A Boys Cross Country State Champions, the Woodlands High Cross Country Team. Dr. Stockton.
We have found over the years it's much easier to leave this item on the agenda.
Yeah. So
than
true.
To add it. So with that, I want to introduce Mr. Colshan, principal of the Woodlands High School.
Dr. Stockton, Mrs. Bush, members of the board, again, thank you for the opportunity to be here to recognize a very special group of young men and their coaches. Like Dr. Stockton mentioned, we've been here a couple times for cross country before. Coach Green is in his ninth year as the head cross country coach, and he's been here five times, which gives him a better winning percentage than his father, who was 50%. Coach Green is now a little bit over 50%. Not that there's any family competition going on. So, you know, these guys work very, very hard all year long. There is no off season in distance running. And they are here very early in the morning and do it again in the afternoon, and are a very dedicated group of young men. So at this time, I'd like to introduce our head cross country coach, Juris Green.
All right. Well, thank you all for having us, Mr. Stockton and members of the board. This doesn't get old. Every year, I know I say that. I don't know if you remember what I say from year to year, season to season, but it never does. And maybe one of the reasons is I get to wear a suit. You know, generally I'm in sweats and not very nice out, and but now I get to dress up in my Sunday best every once in a while. But I want to thank you for having us, and you know, it's fair to say this program over 40 plus years has had its fair share of success, and I think some of the times it gets glanced over. Oh, they won again. They've done it again. They've done this or that. And Mr. Colshan made a good point. After the state meet, we had just done all the calculations and the unofficial results came out that we were unofficially the winners, and made a point that, you know, it's one thing to get to the top, but it's a very different feeling to repeat as a state champion, and it's even there's a different set of challenges to three-peat. In fact, after as well, in a private meeting that the team and I had on the bus afterwards, once the awards are over, I made a point to them that, you know, putting on one of our jerseys, yes, they're very lightweight and they're top of the line material, but putting that jersey on oftentimes feels like an anchor around your neck with what the program asks of these volunteers. They're not conscripted. You know, they chose to run for this program, but a program that regularly asks more of what they even expect of themselves shouldn't go unnoted. We had an atypical year this year, starting in the summer with the loss of one of our teammates and one of my boys, and then the hurricane. I think many people would have said it was okay for us not to have accomplished what we did this season, and yet here we are. And you know, I've tipped my hat many times to these guys for what they've carried, not only what it says on their chest when they race, but the other things as well. And I said in a newspaper article, or interview after the state meet, you know, we got our bus to go to Round Rock, and it was an elementary school bus from Ford Elementary. You know, those buses are color-coded. And the color on the front of the bus was Tanner Noble's favorite color, teal. It was here. And you can't tell me that's a coincidence, or just a coincidence. And I knew something special was going to happen. I didn't know when. And in fact, you know, as the race was unfolding with 600 meters left, Gavin is battling, and he's in fourth place and trying to move up, and I'm screaming that he can win. He's 3 or 4 seconds behind a leader at that time, and there's a small footbridge about 400 meters from the finish. And with parent video and website video afterwards, we calculated that we were 6 points behind South Lake Carroll with basically 60 seconds left to run over 5,000 meters. And within that 60 seconds, our top five scorers passed exactly 30 people and not only made up the 6 points, but put 6 points on South Lake Carroll for us to secure our 20th state title in our program's history. Saying that, I'd like to introduce these seven members. Our state runner-up, second-place finisher, Gavin Hoffpar. Senior Daniel Baker. Senior Ryan Rayford. Senior Ethan Mercado. Senior Austin Childry. Senior Matt Jones. And our young one, our sophomore, Ethan Hammer. And my assistant coach, Chris Bales.
On behalf of the board, I'm actually very honored to get to present to you boys and Coach Green this plaque. When Ms. Bush asked me to do this, I've been thinking about it all day, how honored I was to actually get to do this for you guys, because I know how hard it is to be a student athlete, especially today with such a wonderful school and principal that's demanding the absolute best out of you guys academically. And you're doing that in the classroom, and you're also doing it out on the field as well. And I was thinking of just some things that I could say, but actually I was hoping that you guys were getting some great leadership, and there's really nothing else I could add. Coach Green, what a wonderful example you are of a leader for these boys in this program, expecting much more out of them than just winning these championships, but for them to be well-rounded individuals that can achieve their goals. So I appreciate that, the tradition that you have set and carried on through your entire family. When my wife and I first moved here, we were talking about things that we would get our future kids involved with, and someone told us at that point, you really need to get involved in the cross-country program because they have a great tradition and they demand the most out of their kids. So I got an 11-year-old that's going to be coming your way at some point. But on behalf of the school board, we would like to present you guys your 6A state championship plaque and congratulate each one of you. So thank you for what you've done.
Congratulations to you.
Congratulations.
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 Godfrey, has anyone registered to address the board?
Yes.
The next 30 minutes have been designated for public participation by patrons who have signed up to address the board in accordance with board policy BED. Please remember that the board may not discuss or act upon any issues that are not posted on our agenda. The board has adopted complaint policies that are designed to secure at the lowest administrative level a prompt and equitable resolution of complaints and concerns. These policies provide that if a resolution cannot be reached administratively, the person may appeal the administrative decision to the board as a properly posted agenda item. Copies of the district's complaint policies can be found on the district's website. Those who have registered to address the board will be limited to 5 minutes for their presentation. Delegations of more than five must appoint one representative to present their views to the board. Ms. Godfrey, please call the first person who has signed up to address the board.
Sherry Shorten.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
What you have before you is a packet of information that was provided to Commissioner's Court this morning. It has come to my attention that the Conroe ISD Board has the 1,700 votes to allocate to the Montgomery Central Appraisal District candidates. And as a result, I am adamantly asking the Conroe ISD Board not to allocate any votes to Mr. Eric Yalick. This packet here has been provided with a lot of information with supporting documents that justify my request. Again, this was read this morning, and this 1,700 votes, obviously you have the votes to make two more position appointments from the list of 13 candidates. And the information provided shows that Mr. Yalick's ethics, morality, and his intent to bring reform are very much so in question. In reality, Mr. Yalick's policies tend to try to find solutions by creating discord. And as a school district, you are very much aware that teamwork isn't about the only thing that gets things done. There are many, many players in the process and many, many things that need to happen. being aware that the policies and procedures are set at the state level for property tax, the appraisal district board members have to enforce the state laws, rather than try to find loopholes in the state laws and rather than try to circumvent those state laws. It would be much better to have someone on the board who is dedicated to enforcing the law and publicly going to the state and talking to our representatives to get the things that are wrong changed in the system. And I appreciate your time. If there's any questions, I'd be glad to answer them, you know, when you have time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms.
Short. Thank you,
Ms. Short. Amen. All right. Item 3 is a consent agenda. I've had requests to remove items E and F, so I need a motion to approve if there's no others that want to remove anything else.
Motion to approve with the said amendments removed. Agenda items removed.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? All right. Item E, consider purchase of approximately 1.744 acre tract adjacent to Austin Elementary. Mr. Husbands.
Yes, I simply asked to have this removed because I think the purchase of land on behalf of the district is an item that needs to be openly aired and the reason for it and such. So I just have a couple of questions. It is my understanding this 1.7 odd acres is purchased for the additional retention or detention, I'm not sure I'm using the right word, so either one or both, for the Austin renovation, and that it was cheaper to purchase the 1.7 acres at appraised value than it was to put the retention underground, such as we did at Travis years ago. Would that be an accurate statement?
That statement is accurate. We spent a great deal of effort analyzing at least six different detention options before we even looked to go outside our school's footprint that we currently own.
Right.
So we found this option is one of three options we looked at off-site, and it is the least expensive land option. It is also the best engineering option to suit our needs.
Very good. That's all the questions I have. Thank you. I move the approval of item E.
Second.
All right. Any further questions?
I have none.
All right. All those in favor? Motion passes. Item F, consider approval of 2017-18 request for class size waiver.
And
Mr. Husband.
I guess it's just my night to extend the board meeting time, but I apologize. But this one, I just wanted to make sure that I was, again, that I was informed here. You know, a lot of districts ask for waivers, and they ask for a lot of waivers to keep from having to hire the appropriate number of teachers. I think in this case, though, there's an exception, as Conroe is an exceptional district. And I, correct me if I'm wrong, there's approximately 30 classrooms in the entire district, K through 4, that have, I think all but two of them have one more student than the 22-to-1, and a couple of them have one or two more.
Correct. We have 27 classrooms that have one additional student, one classroom with two, and one classroom with three. What we've always done is we've asked for flexibility because we go and rely on the campus to make that decision to add another teacher, because sometimes with one extra student, they don't want to split a class. Sometimes campuses will ask for a paraprofessional position to add to the class, and then sometimes our enrollment changes. So we may bump over on one day, and then a week later we may come down. So we provide that flexibility. We've hired approximately 16 teachers since the year started to address growth, and we'll continue to monitor that with your permission.
So these campuses have chosen, these 29 classrooms, I guess it is, that have chosen to either address it with paras or keep it the same or one extra student or whatever it may be, not because we forced it on them as a budgetary item or anything like that.
No, or continue to monitor it for a later date.
I understand. And I know populations, school populations are an ebb and flow thing. So anyway, that's the only question I have, ma'am, and I move the approval there as well.
All right.
Second.
Any other questions? All those in favor? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Item 4A. Consider approval of 2017-2018 District Improvement Plan.
Okay.
Dr. Stockton.
With that, I'll ask Dr. Null to come and present those two items.
No, I had my own sound effects.
It sounded like an Amber Alert.
Well, President Bush, members of the board, Dr. Stockton, I'm here tonight to present to you and seek your approval of our District Improvement Plan. The District Improvement Plan is a very comprehensive document. I know you've had an opportunity to look at it over the last few weeks, but I would remind you that the District Improvement Plan, as well as the campus improvement plans, they are living documents. So they are documents that we don't just produce and put on a shelf, but we revisit those throughout the year, and they may change throughout the year as our strategies change. But our District Improvement Plan, it highlights the academic and operational strategic goals for the district. It not only outlines the goals, but it outlines our strategies to achieve those goals, and then explicitly states how we will measure to find out if we were successful or not with our goals. It is a very collaborative effort. You know, all departments in the district work together to produce the document, and then we present this document to the district level planning and decision making committee. And when we do those presentations, rather than just come one night and present this entire document and all the goals, we break it down so that month by month they hear one or two goals, and they hear directly from the department that is responsible for that. So for example, when it's when they're going to hear the goal about technology, we bring the technology department in for them to share with them that goal and how it will be achieved. And we think that's very effective so that we don't bombard them with all the information in one night. So our district level committee has had a chance to hear all of our goals, and they have approved our district improvement plan, and tonight I'm here to answer any questions you may have and then seek your approval of our district improvement plan.
I move the nomination. Or approve.
A second.
All right. Any questions, discussion? None? All right. All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you, Dr. Knoll. Item 4B, consider approval of the 2017-2018 campus improvement plans. Dr. Stockton.
Okay, at this time I'll ask Mr. Caker and Dr. Phillips to come present the campus improvement plans.
Good evening, President Bush, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. Dr. Phillips and I are here tonight to ask for your approval of the 2017-2018 campus improvement plans. As you know, the campus plans are unique to each campus and done in conjunction with the principal and the site-based decision-making committee at each campus. All of the CIPs align with the district plan outlined by Dr. Knoll and follow a common template that ensures the consistency of process and product that are part of the areas identified for inclusion in the campus improvement plans. Each campus, in their commitment to continuous improvement, works to identify areas of focus within the plan and writes goals and objectives to support the achievement of every student, overall success of each campus and of our district. The campus improvement plan, as Dr. Knoll mentioned, is a living document which is monitored and adjusted throughout the year by the campus improvement committee. In developing the campus improvement plan, each campus must also submit an itemized budget outlining how state compensatory education funds, title funds, other state federal funds, and high school allotment funds support the plan. We are here to welcome your questions, take any comments, and seek your approval for the campus improvement plans.
Motion to approve the plan as presented.
Mr. Moore, second. Any discussion, questions? All right. All those in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baker and Dr. Phillips.
Thank you.
Item 5A, receive the 2018-2019 school calendar information. Dr. Stockton.
Okay, it's that time of year. We're working on our school calendar. I'll ask Dr. Knoll to come present the information.
Good evening once again. It is that time of year where we begin the process of working on our school calendar, and I'll just share with you a brief overview of our timeline of the calendar process. And this is a tentative timeline. It's one that can be flexible if as we move forward, if we feel a need to slow down, we can do that. But when it's possible, we try to bring this information to our community really as soon as it's appropriate to do so. It starts back really in October. We begin to work on a few draft calendars that we may share with the district level planning and decision making committee. And at last month's meeting of that committee, we shared with them just some big parameters of the process and tried to prepare them for the process so that they were ready to begin to make decisions. And we come to you tonight to seek your input and your guidance that we would go back and share with them tomorrow when they meet. Because when they meet tomorrow, we will do our best to produce draft calendars that will be ready to be presented to the public. We've had years where we've presented one draft calendar to put out for comment. We've had years that we've had up to three. But that will be placed on our website to go out for comment. Last year, we had over 2,000 comments come in through our website. So it's a very effective mechanism to receive public input on our calendars. So our goal will be to, by the end of this month, to have those calendars put up, and that will run through the beginning of January. And then our committee will meet on January 10th. And at that time, their goal will be to select a calendar that we will then present to you at the January board meeting for approval. And want to share with you just a few of the highlights of the calendar and some things that we've already seen and noted as we've worked through the early drafts. We will have 177 days of instruction. This was a number that you approved earlier this year when you approved a waiver for additional staff development day. We'll have four early release days. Once again, that's based on a waiver that you've approved. Those four early release days will be at the end of each of our 9-week grading periods. 187 days for teachers, and a significant number for us next year is 75,600. That's the number of instructional minutes that are required now by the state of Texas. It's no longer about number of days, it's about number of minutes, and that magic number is 75,600. We also build into our calendar, historically, extra minutes so that if we had to miss two days because of inclement weather, our students would not have to make those days up. So that's a change that's happened in our calendar over the last few years. You no longer see student makeup days included on our calendar, and that's because we've built in the extra minutes in the calendar. Moving forward, we consider start date. The traditional start date for next year would be August 27th. And as you'll remember, because we are a district of innovation, we have an option to start school earlier as we did this year. That day for next year, if we followed the same template that we did this year, would be August the 15th. I would tell you that most of the early feedback that we've received, not only from the district level committee, but from campuses as we've traveled around, is that was a pretty popular decision, and the midweek start was very popular as well. We had an October holiday this year that was also well received by parents and students alike and teachers. Thanksgiving break, historically, in our most recent history, we've taken a week off at Thanksgiving. We always make note of the first semester end date. And looking at our different options of the calendar, depending on when we may end, once again, the calendar is really a balanced mathematical equation, mm-hmm. Okay? You take a day off somewhere, you add it somewhere else. It's just the way that it works. And so of a few of the draft calendars we've produced, we would anticipate the first semester ending somewhere between December 19th and December 21st, depending upon which way we may go, with students returning back, teachers returning back on January 7th and students returning back on January 8th. That's very similar to where we are this year. One of the challenges with this calendar is just the way the calendar falls. And I would tell you, looking ahead at the 19-20 calendar, we get a little more back to normal where yeah. school could come back that first week of January. The challenge here that we face is if teachers came back on the 2nd, students came back on Thursday the 3rd, mm-hmm. campuses are very concerned that attendance would be very poor for Thursday and Friday only classes. So that's something that we've really had to take into account. Spring break. There are really two options for spring break, the 11th to the 15th, which Houston ISD has already approved their calendar, and that's the spring break week they chose. The only university that we've seen so far has been the University of Texas, and they chose the next week, 18th to the 22nd.
That's
so,
obviously the right one.
Okay. And there goes our Longhorn.
Right. So that may be one that we would still want to wait and see yeah. more things come out. Either of those spring breaks, I would tell you, would work well with our academic calendar as far as ending a 9 weeks right before the spring break. Either would work. So we kind of have that flexibility. And then looking at end date, once again, depending upon how we choose to take certain days off, I see a potential for us to possibly end school on May 24th for students, which would be before Memorial Day, or if we had a few more days off along the way, still having the ability to end school on May 30th and having teachers and students out still by the end of May. So those options exist. And so I'll really, if you have any feedback or questions that you'd have me share with them tomorrow as they begin to work through it, I would welcome those.
Let's go down the line.
Yeah, the only feedback I've heard, I know last year there was some trepidation with the earlier start date, and we got a lot of comments on that. But once we put it out there and people lived into it, I've heard a lot of positive comments that people, they like that, and they like the semester break before Christmas.
Yes.
And they like ending as early as possible. So.
Okay. Yes, sir.
We all do, right?
Yes.
If you started on the 15th, again, that Wednesday in the middle of August, okay?
Yes, sir.
What days off would keep you from ending school on the 24th?
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Okay,
so to end school on the 24th, we would need to go to school on December 21st. That'd be a half day. You know, that's one day later than we're going this year, but that is a half day.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, we would follow really the calendar that we have this year.
The full week of Thanksgiving.
Yes, sir. We'd have still the full week of Thanksgiving. We still have.
You lose October, don't you?
No, sir. We would have October. We would have April 19th, and we could still get to May 24th.
Okay. It,
Yes, sir. And so the, you know, a tentative alternative that was created was just if we felt like getting out for winter break on the 21st was too late, we wanted to get out on the 19th instead and perhaps take the Monday after Good Friday off. That would push us back to May 31st. So it's just the more common, if we followed really this year's calendar and just went to school on December 21st, we could achieve May 24th. Now, May 24th would be the last day for students. That'd be a Friday.
Right.
Which would mean teachers would work May 25th, which would be the Saturday of the holiday weekend. Now, principals are flexible, and they could work that out with folks that may have a conflict. But that's just a reality of
Make that on the Tuesday, the 28th instead?
Well, we could. I think a majority of folks would. We could have that conversation, certainly. I think a majority of folks would rather come and be done and leave for the weekend.
On a holiday weekend?
And are finished.
And never come back.
And never come back. Okay.
You know, we used to have, traditionally.
Well, we wanted to come back in August.
Yeah. We've had three graduations before that day.
That
Saturday, so all the high schools were working. And I think we could be flexible if that was the calendar.
So what are the days in December and January this year? Pardon me for not knowing, but I don't have.
So this year we get out the 20th.
20th on a
Wednesday?
Yes,
sir.
And you go back when?
9th.
Wow.
Okay. And next year, like I said, the calendar does turn a little more in favor of squeezing that, but we're sort of in no man's land.
Yeah.
And the other feedback that we've gotten very strong over the years is having three weekends for the winter break.
Yeah. Dr. Knoll and I have gone round and round about this, but that's just the nature of my business and not anything else. The feedback that I've received has been very positive about the early start. I think last year it caught a lot of people off guard because they planned their vacations prior to us setting the calendar, and that was a educational opportunity for us to inform them that they really shouldn't plan on when we would start until February when the calendar is set. And so I've had people even reach out to me now saying, are we looking at a potential early start against next year? And I'm like, yes, but until February, I can't tell you for sure what we're going to be doing. So that's been very positive. And then the other thing I keep hearing constantly is if we can get out before Memorial Day, the parents really would like that. So
sure.
I love this.
Thank you.
I'll defer. You're to good. You guys. Whatever you put on the calendar, that's when I'll send mine.
We can't go to an all year long.
That's my preference. I'll cut that down to whatever else.
A couple of days early.
Good way.
And yes, Mr. Sanders, Mr. Hubert.
No issues.
My question is if on the May 24th, last day of school in May 2019?
Yes, sir.
If we do that, when would the graduations be? They're typically before that, I understand. But
yes.
Would we still be able to get the graduations out before the holidays?
So we are at the, you know, for four of our schools, we are at the mercy of the pavilion. I would tell you, we kind of started working on these drafts. I started doing these in September. Mm-hmm. And once I saw that was a possibility, like it looked like it could happen, I went ahead and made contact with the pavilion just to give them the heads up that this might be real. We might be able to make that happen. And so they have penciled us in for that week before. Now, nothing's confirmed yet. And so once you approve the calendar, if that's the end date we choose, I'll go back to them with the firm date. But our goal would be to graduate that, you know, probably that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday of that week for the pavilion. And then we would work out Caney Creek and Hawk, you know, on the front end or the back end, whichever fits more appropriately for them.
Okay, very good. No, I'm the same way. I mean, it's had very positive feedback on that as well.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Knoll.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 5B, select commissioning agents for building commissioning and building envelope commissioning services and delegate authority to superintendent. Dr. Stockton.
Easy Foster, please.
So, President Bush, members of the board, and Dr. Stockton, it's my pleasure to bring forward for your consideration and approval a selection of a pool of commissioning agents that we're intending to use for the services of commissioning our mechanical systems and our building envelope systems. We bring this to you for your approval because of some recent code adoptions in the energy code in our state and our local municipality that now require third-party commissioning agents be used for building envelope and building mechanical systems. So we published an RFQ. We had seven firms respond to the RFQ. After grading that with our committee against our criteria, we're selecting a pool of three of those seven to have at our use to finish out our 2015 bond project. This time that pool is the DLR Group, Bryson Gardner Consultants, and Envy Engineering. At this point, we're asking you to approve this selection.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Second.
Any questions, discussion? All right. All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you, Mr. Foster. Select construction manager at risk for 2019 life cycle. Mr. Foster.
At this time, I bring forward for your approval the selection of a construction manager at risk for our 2019 life cycle project, which covers MEP systems, athletics life cycle items, and building envelope lifetime items, which are roofs and joint sealants and things like windows and things of that nature. In November of 2015, we selected PBK as our architect for our 2019 life cycle project, and PBK has helped us by publishing an RFQ for construction managers at risk. We had two companies respond to our RFQ. Based on our criteria, we selected both of them to participate in step two of our two-step selection process, which we received pricing from, and then interviewed both contractors. Contractors selected as the best offer, GTT Construction was selected as the best offer who submitted a proposal we deemed to be the best value for the district. At this time, we've got the rankings and that evaluation as part of this item, and we're requesting you approve this selection.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Questions, comments?
How big is that, I know it hadn't been bid, but how big is that package in general? $15 million?
No, for 2019, we've advertised $6.2
million. Yeah. Oh, so much smaller than that.
Yeah, it'll be the waning part of our 2015 bond project.
Anything else? All those in favor? Motion passes. Item 5D, consider approval of the guaranteed maximum price amendment for 2018 life cycle project. Mr. Foster.
At this time, I request your approval of the guaranteed maximum price amendment for our 2018 life cycle project. Again, this covers our MEP systems, our athletics life cycle, and our building envelope life cycles. In November of 2016, we selected GTT as the construction manager at risk for our 2018 life cycle project. Since then, we've designed the plans, we've advertised, take bids from the marketplace, and GTT has prepared a proposal for their work. We've negotiated a guaranteed maximum price of $12,793,063 for the 2018 life cycle work. At this time, we're requesting your approval of the GMP amount.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion passes. Capital improvement update. Mr. Foster, it's your time.
This time I'd like to bring you up to speed on our capital improvements that we have underway throughout the district. Starting with our safety and security project, which we are nearing the end of phase two, so a representative picture of the entry vestibule at one of our campuses. We are still above the ceilings, but we're at a point where we're making systems talk to each other so we can see all the new camera views, make sure all the new access control systems are working so that we can release them to the campuses for their full use in the very near future. The project is scheduled to go through the end of December, and it is on schedule and proceeding as we would anticipate it to.
Is this a camera view, or is this just a picture?
This is just a picture.
Okay. Well, if it's that clear, that's a pretty awesome system. But
the cameras that we are installing are
like
a very good quality, so we can get good image representation from them. So. Now, we are currently working through the process of collecting data on more campuses so we can bring you phase three in the spring for your approval of that GMP. Moving on to Grand Oaks High School. Grand Oaks High School is on schedule. It's scheduled to open in August of 2018. which is approximately 39 weeks away. So as you can see here, the overall progress of the site is moving along very well. The roofing system is going in mm-hmm. in its final form. The athletics venues, which you can see clearly, are taking their shape as the grass is going in on the practice fields and the turf is going in on the other athletic venues in that site. Interior of the building, the finishes are beginning to come together. We're finishing the academic, which is the front three-story part of the building first, and moving towards the athletics and the fine arts and CTE areas in the back. So we're starting to see some of the finishes and some of the colors and other things inside that building come alive. As I said, it is on schedule, scheduled to open in August.
Mr. Foster, on that, are you and Principal Povich hoping that the calendar will be moved back? Start date.
Yeah. Are you on track for an August 15th start potentially?
It's got to be turned over a lot sooner than that.
Absolutely. And I'm happy to report for when we're the contract with the contractor is scheduled to finish that building in June.
Good.
So that we have June and July and part of August, either some of or all of, to move our furniture and get it set up for the students. So we did prepare this one adequately for some flexibility for our calendar process.
We actually had this conversation before the calendar was approved. Just to double check.
Madam President, we'll let the board know if we need anybody to move furniture that last night.
Well, we will be looking for people with trucks and dollies.
So oh, there you go.
If you've got a truck.
You have a truck, I know.
Work out.
All right, we're going to move on to Clark Intermediate, which is also on schedule. It is scheduled to open in August, right alongside of Grand Oaks High School. So you can see from this picture, the building structure at the front door is coming together, mm-hmm. And the interior of that building is also coming together. What you can see as we move around that building is the building systems on the what we call the tough end of the building, where the kitchen equipment and the main electrical service, things of that nature, that is proceeding very rapidly. So you will see pictures begin to parallel Grand Oaks High School as we move forward. Both of them are on the same schedule for finish and turnover so that we can have adequate time with our staff and our purchasing department can furnish it, outfit it. Our technology department can set up the desk tables and chairs and computer workstations so that they can function for the start of school whenever it happens to be in August of 2018.
Better than average weather. Yeah. Awesome general contractor.
It's been good.
Subs. Why?
Well, we go through a very detailed process to make sure we get the best contractors we could possibly get.
But why are you ahead of even on schedule?
We're I would not argue that we're ahead of schedule. We're right where we would need to be at this point in the year to turn it over in at the end of May.
I just misheard what you said.
And if I misspoke, I sincerely apologize. But if you ask the contractor, he's got his head down, his elbows up, and he's behind schedule. So he's working hard. Now, moving over to Conroe High School, where we're doing an addition renovation project, which will allow us to do a major mechanical overhaul of the main campus. Mm-hmm. You're looking at the building structure for the central plant, which is the heartbeat of the mechanical system that's being upgraded on that campus. Over the next month or so, you'll see those two big supports in the back of that picture house the cooling towers, which are the, you know, kind of the heartbeat of keeping our chillers in operation. The pads you're looking at are pump pads and chiller pads for all that mechanical equipment that will be delivered in the not too distant future.
Have they been covered in the past? Or is that a new technique?
Well, it depends on the system. So most of the systems at Conroe High School currently are air-cooled systems, which are out in the elements. We are upgrading that system for a better, more efficient water-cooled system. Uh-huh. So the cooling towers are out in the elements, but the chillers themselves are inside a contained environment.
Life?
It does, absolutely.
Awesome.
And the water-cooled systems are leaps and bounds more efficient than air-cooled systems. Mm-hmm. And putting it in a central plant allows us to expand it as that campus grows over time, without ending up with the systems like we have at Conroe High School currently, where there's chillers behind every building all over the place. They'll all be centrally located, and we can pipe to everything else from here moving forward.
Thanks for the explanation.
Now, the building addition, which is the main component that allows us to work on the main portion of that building, this structure is going up now, so we're going to have classrooms here. It's more or less for the purposes of this construction swing space to move students into as we renovate other portions of the building. I would like to report this project is on schedule, but we are scheduled to be on campus through December of 2019. And that's our update.
Thank you, Mr. Foster. Item 6A, consider award of RFP 17-01-01A, contracted educational services.
Mr. Rice, if you'll present that item and the next two items.
Good evening, President Bush, members of the board, and Dr. Stockton. Tonight, I'm recommending the Board of Trustees award RFP 17-01-01A, contracted educational services, professional development, and education consulting services, November 2017. To the 24 vendors listed on the attached tabulation for an estimated annual expenditure of approximately $25,000. The district has requested proposals from 350 vendors for these services. Thus far, 160 vendors have been awarded since June of 2017. The $25,000 is included in the previously awarded annual estimate of $1.5 million. The recommended vendors submitted responses between October 1st and October 31st, 2017. Service contracts with awarded vendors will remain firm through November 30th, 2018, with an option to renew annually for four additional one-year terms through November 30th, 2022. And at this time, I recommend your approval.
I move they be approved as presented.
I second the motion.
Questions, comments? All right, all those in favor? Thank you, Mr. Rice. Consider and adopt an order authorizing the issuance of Conroe Independent School District unlimited tax school building bonds. Mr. Rice.
Yes, tonight I'm recommending the Board of Trustees approve the order authorizing the issuance of Conroe Independent School District unlimited tax school building bonds, setting certain parameters for the bonds, authorizing the superintendent and the chief financial officer to approve the amount, the interest rate, price, including the terms thereof, and certain other procedures and provisions related thereto. The parameter order is for the sale of Conroe Independent School District School Bond Series 2018. The approximately new issue amount is $202 million from the 2015 bond referendum. The bond sale will provide funds for a new junior high school in the Conroe Feeder Zone, building a new elementary in the Oak Ridge Feeder Zone, renovations and additions to Conroe High School and Austin Elementary, safety and security projects, life cycle replacement projects, and technology. At this time, I would like to just recognize a couple of folks that are with us this evening. From Andrew Skirth, we have Tom Sage and Ben Morse. If you have any legal questions, we will guide for that. And then also we have Mr. John Roebuck, the district's financial advisor here, that's going to present our schedule of events.
Thank you.
John? Thank you, Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Mr.
President Bush, members of the board, Dr. Stockton, good evening. Last time I was out here, it was August 15th, and we had a refunding to show you. Mm-hmm. I don't think we've actually presented to the board, but I think they've seen the results of it.
Yes.
Yes.
I think I was showing you $10.5 million, but at the end of the day, we actually ended up saving a little over $14.5 million.
Yes.
So congratulations. Mm-hmm. Great news. We are here tonight to talk and ask for your approval on a parameter to issue the last of your remaining authorization from the November 2015 bond authorization. And this could be the third or, you know, potentially final sale of the authorization. I always like to start off by going through, overview of the bond market. This is, again, the bond buyer index. This is the average rate of municipal bonds across the country for general obligation debt. This chart was actually updated last week to get in time for your agenda packet. The rates actually has dropped. It's actually now at 3.49%. It dropped after the House released its tax reform bill. But then the Senate released their bill, and it went back up. So we don't know what this week's rate is, but we think it's going to be close to probably 3.67 again. So we've kind of stayed in this relative range. What's going to happen with the tax reform bill, we're not quite sure yet. Obviously, as you have property casualty companies change the way they do their taxes. You have corporations reduce their taxes, individuals reduce their tax. People are going to be looking for a little higher tax equivalent yield. So yields may go up if it passes in the current form. But again, the current form is still being discussed, so there's really no telling what's going to happen.
No, my friend.
With that being said, page 2 is the debt service for the proposed $202 million bond issue. Now, we're showing $190,195,000 of bonds being issued because of premium. We ran this with current market scale to see how it looked in your tax rate model. But this will generate $202 million. This is at current rate, current market rates. So when it's all said and done, the total debt service requirements are there on the far right. We are here tonight asking for your approval for the parameter order. Parameter order is a not-to-exceed amount of the $202 million. The maximum maturity cannot exceed 30 years. And then the true interest cost of the bonds shall not exceed 5%. We think if we sold the bonds today, we'd be closer to the 4% range, and actually probably less than that, probably closer to 3.85%. With your credit, it would probably be a little lower than that. But if you all approve this tonight, we will start working with the rating companies. Actually, we have rating calls scheduled on Friday. We already have a draft of the document ready to go. And then look to sell potentially the week of December 14th. If it's not a good time to sell, we'll with the beauty of the parameter orders, it allows us the flexibility to push it back or move it forward, depending if we have ratings and everything in place. But again, you know, if it's week of the 11th, we'll do it then. If not, then we'll wait till January and do it in January.
Okay.
Thank you. With that, I'll be happy to answer your questions. Again, Interscurts here, they drafted the legal documents. We drafted, you know, obviously, the numbers, but I'd be answering questions you have.
Yeah, we need to move to approve this. There's not an official.
I move to approve.
Yeah, I second that motion.
Request.
I second that motion, John.
Any questions?
It's great timing, great idea.
All right, all those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you for being here tonight.
We appreciate it.
We appreciate you being here and your leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, item 6C, receive financial reports. Mr. Rice.
All right, I'm here this evening to present the financial statements for the month of October. These financial statements will include our general fund, debt service, child nutrition, and self-funded insurance. The first statement we'll look at this evening is our balance sheet. The balance sheet includes our assets, our liabilities, and our fund balances for the district. Each month, we like to take a look at our cash and investments. And we'll concentrate once again on the general fund. We show that we have cash on hand of $13,300, bank deposits of $141,000, investments in state pools of $98.4 million, short-term investments, $29.7 million, and investments with TCG Investment Advisors, $51.6 million for total cash and investments of $179.8 million. The next statement we'll look at this evening is the income statement. The income statement has our revenues and expenditures and fund balances. Our revenues are broken down into three categories. They include local and intermediate sources, state program revenues, and federal program revenues. And taking a look at our year-to-date expenditures by major category, we can see that payroll is the number one expenditure in the general fund, debt service in the debt service fund, in child nutrition, it's supplies and materials, and in self-funded insurance, it's contracted services. This is our 2015 bond referendum status update for the month of October. A combination of our 2015 bond referendum and the funds transferred from the general fund total $520.2 million. Our projected forecast at the completion of the bond referendum is $514.8 million, leaving us with contingency of $5.4 million. We've currently encumbered and expended $302.7 million. And our estimate to complete the projects, we need to spend an additional $212 million. Great news to report on our self-funded insurance. We had another good month in the month of October. For the year, we've had total revenues of a little over $8 million. We've had expenses just a little over $6 million for our revenues over expenses of $1.9 million. Participation at the wellness centers has been going very well. That number keeps ticking up. Mm-hmm. We actually had 75 visits at the North County Clinic, so I see that continually getting better participation.
Good.
So our investments for the month. We ended the month of October with $319.6 million of par value. Our pools were yielding 1.26%. Our short-term investments, 1.33%. Our longer-term investments with TCG Investment Advisors, 1.25%, giving our combined portfolio a WAM of 71 days yielding 1.27%. And our benchmark, which is the 90-day T-bill, was a little over 1%. And that is all.
Thank you, Mr. Rice.
Great job.
We're going to move item 9, legal, up to before executive session so that we can get all this done, and then we'll go into executive session so that anything any of y'all need to be here for, we've handled, and then y'all can go home while we do executive session. So, item 9A, consider resolution to cast votes and cast our votes for the election of the 2018-19 Montgomery Central Appraisal District Board of Directors. Mrs. Gladys.
Thank you, Mrs. Bush. As you know, every other year you guys have this item. It calls for you to pass a resolution to cast votes for the Board of Directors of the Montgomery County Central Appraisal District, and then to cast your votes. You have 1,739 votes to cast. There are 13 possible candidates on your ballot. You can cast them all for one. You can divide them any way you see fit for any of the candidates on the ballot. And so I will turn it over to you to decide how. I'm assuming you'll want to
discuss first, and then we'll decide and vote how we want to do this. So,
Madam President, I have a question for Mrs.
Yes, sir.
Sorry. Anyway, Gladys, I really do know your name is.
Yeah. it's
quite it's been 10 years.
Is it 20. Only 20 years or so?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
700 votes virtually guarantees somebody a position.
That is what we believe.
In the past have done.
Yes, in that range, that is what we've awarded.
I just wanted to establish sure. That, yes. You know, it make sure that I was right. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Madam President, you're thank you.
All right. I know that some people really want to discuss this, and kind of the discussion seems to be, I think we need to kind of go person by person and decide, are we going to vote for one, two, three? We can vote for a total of five. However, we would want to divvy that up. But
I guess you could vote for more than five if you want. If you have,
but you have to go in order, though. Yeah.
I don't know that we have to go in order, but I think there was some desire to have discussion.
Have the time to vote one-on-one rather than a slate.
Sure.
So that we can each talk about the candidates as we want to.
But I would also, instead of just voting for each one of the candidates, I'd like to talk about how you split those votes to make it most effective.
Yes.
I'd like to suggest that we cast 700 even votes for Mr. Lucy, okay? And then I'll let everybody else go from there, or chime back in or whatever, but I just like to start it there, please. And I mean, and the reason why is I think 700 will lock his position. I'm very impressed with what I know and hear of this gentleman, and I'll let other people who know him better than I do expound on that. But
I know Mr. Lucy personally. I think he's an exceptional guy, a very sound judgment. He brings a wealth of value, a very, you know, clean kind of understanding of how things should run in a manner that doesn't create chaos. He's a military Air Force Academy grad. Like I said, my wife and I have known him. He has two kids in CISD, one in McCullough, one at Powell. Just a great, well-rounded guy, level-headed, no real political or any self-serving ambition. He's just a great guy that any one of us could relate to, and I think he represents us well on the board. So definitely my recommendation.
I would agree with that wholeheartedly. I think Mr. Luzzi's an awesome fella. I'd like to see a little more votes go to Mr. Lucy. I know that the MUDs are going to all vote for Mr. Hoffheiser, mm-hmm. and that's going to total 712. And I want to at least make sure that we get enough to where he makes it onto that board. Mm-hmm. So I it's just a suggestion.
What's your number?
How many?
Well, we have. It depends on how we want to split them up, I think. You know,
I just don't think 700 votes can be outvoted, Ray. It may not be first place.
Right.
But there's no way that nobody has enough votes to make it happen.
Right.
Okay.
And that's my reason for choosing 700. I can't guarantee that. I don't know, you know, but like you said, all the MUDs vote there.
Right.
The county is the next biggest, and they've issued their votes already.
Right.
Which we haven't even got to in the discussion. And so to lock in either one of the county or none of them, whatever, it takes less votes for those candidates to give them the 700 margin,
yep.
or whatever. And I mean, if it's 712 you want or 13, we've got the votes if that makes you comfortable. I don't.
That just like it to be a little more than 712.
Fair enough.
That's my only suggestion.
Okay.
So, Mr. Sanders, I'm going to ask, what are you thinking?
Well, about all the candidates? I mean, my general thought on candidates are, of course, I nominated Mr. Blanton, mm-hmm. and I would like to make sure that we apply enough votes for him to be elected to the appraisal district as well. And the only other comment that I have is I know that some of the candidates that, of all the packets we got, some of the candidates are already elected officials. And my only thought is that an employee of a taxing authority is not eligible to serve on the appraisal district board, but an elected official with that taxing authority is eligible to serve. And I just see that as a conflict of interest. They're setting tax rates and then they're being on the board. They have to abstain anytime there's discussions about the appraisal district in their own taxing authority. And so I just see that as an appearance of a conflict of interest. It may or may not be, and I'm not trying to accuse anybody of anything. I just think there's an appearance there. And for those reasons, kind of like Dr. Mel Brown used to not vote for anybody that was alive on a school board or school. Yeah. I have a real problem with voting for an elected official to serve in that capacity as well.
And on that note, I'd take it a little further. I don't think that anyone who is running for an elected position of a taxing entity should be considered as well. And so that would strike one additional person, in my personal opinion. So.
Well, I happen to disagree with that opinion simply because number one, it is not a conflict of interest. It is not against the law. And some of our most seasoned, that board operates a lot like this one. And if everybody started new this year on this board, it would be a tremendous learning curve to catch up. And I know our district's so well run that you don't really see that. But, I mean, there's a lot of moving parts to a multi-hundred million dollar budget. And I disagree wholeheartedly that Mr. Metter, who has served with distinction the county as well as the appraisal board for years, and it personally been notified that from other serving board members who are not running again, that his experience is well needed. And so I don't mean to argue with you, Ray. I just simply think his experience outweighs any conflict of interest that doesn't exist, or they would outlaw it, and it's not. So, and I'm not, and I really don't mean to argue with as much as I like his experience. Let me just say that. So, with that, you know, y'all said,
who are the current board members?
Tom Cox,
Mike Metter,
Ed Chance.
Bruce Tuff.
So and Bruce Tuff's not an elected official any longer.
Correct, not anymore.
And so we could vote our votes for him to make sure that he got on there.
Experience.
And that would provide that experience that you were talking about.
Yes, we could. Or we could give, using your adjusted, just in discussion purposes, if we gave Mr. Luzzi 715 votes, okay, that would answer one of the issues you had.
Mm-hmm.
That would leave 1,014.
Right.
If we gave Mr. Blanton 197, give him the same 715.
Right.
I believe, if my math is right, that would be 717 votes left. I would suggest that we split those 400 to Mike Metter and 317 to Bruce Tuff. And I mean, that's just, you know, that's the way I, plus or minus the minor adjustments there, that's what I walked in here with in my mind. So with that said, I've spoke my piece.
Are you? Any?
Peter?
Well, I'm okay with the 715 as well for Luzzi and Blanton. I also wanted to put some towards Bruce Tuff as well. I think that satisfies the, I don't have anything against Mike Metter at all. But my opinion is I'd like to make sure that we get enough for Bruce Tuff to be on that board as well. So how the numbers work out, I mean.
Well, we don't have enough votes to guarantee,
Not to guarantee both.
Not to guarantee both.
Right.
But we had, but we have in the past. We have in the past, because we have the most votes, if you split it four ways with the right, you know. Now, this year, I will say, is an exception because I don't think Mr. Lucy is going to receive any votes from anywhere else.
Okay.
I just, because of being an unknown newcomer, okay, unknown is relatively speaking. I just, you know, hadn't served on the board in the past. With Barry Blanton getting 500 of the county's votes, I mean, that's easy to see, okay? But with the other, you know, I see two new faces, and I see two old faces, and I think it makes a lot of sense. And I think both of those other candidates, by splitting those votes, will receive votes from other locales. But they don't have enough to influence. But once we cast our votes, they have the luxury of seeing our votes, just like we have the luxury of seeing others.
Well, I'm fine. I'm fine with what your suggestion is.
Well, I mean, it's just an idea.
Could we go with?
Mr. Sanders, do you mind? I want to give Mr. Moore a chance to.
Sure. I didn't have anything to do. I have worked very closely with Mr. Metter when I was at the Precinct 1 Constable's office, a fine man. But I kind of, I'm in line with Mr. Sanders on being uncomfortable with somebody who's setting a tax rate also being on the
advisory board.
On the advisory
board. I mean, it seems like there's at least three, four, I don't know where you stand on that, Mr. Williams, but there's seems to be a consensus among us that we don't really want someone who's sitting on a taxing entity to be elected to the board.
I'm not saying that.
Okay.
I'm not saying that. I'm not sure that it's necessary at this point. We may have the experience we need going elsewhere. Okay. Like I said, I don't believe that, I don't know Mike Metter as well as some of you do, but what little I do know, he's a very upfront and honest and good man, so I don't want to cast a thought that I believe that he would do something inappropriate.
No, I don't think
I understand that, but my thought is more on the lines of if the experience is what we like and maybe a little gray in the hair, then, and I know Bruce wouldn't mind me saying that about him.
Yeah, he probably would.
Maybe he would. He's not here to defend himself, so I'm going to say it. But that's my thought process.
Okay.
Yeah. Can I share one other last?
Please.
No, I didn't have anything.
I'm going to share one last thing. I have a tremendous amount of respect, having gotten to know Mr. Tom Cox for years, and he is one of the persons that suggested experience. He didn't say names to me. Okay, he did not say names to me, but I just, because I wouldn't want to put words in his mouth, but the experience was very important on that board. And I've known Mr. Blanton all my life, and I don't know Mr. Lucy, but I'm encouraged by, you know, new people who have a desire to serve and so on and so forth. I think the experience is way outweighs the conflict or the appearance of conflict or whatever. And so I want to reiterate that. And I trust that board and people that, like, we know how this board works, they have more experience at what actually happens and what is needed than I personally do for the appraisal board. So I wanted to interject that. And like I said, I have a lot of respect for both of those gentlemen, Mr. Metter. I have a lot of respect for Mr. Tuff, and I have a lot of respect for Mr. Cox. And so that's why I feel that way. But I'm ready to move on and let the votes fall where they may.
I was just going to comment. I was at Commissioner's Court this morning when they actually placed the votes. And I found it very interesting that Mr. Metter was willing to not be voted on by his board. He said that if they felt like it was a conflict, since he has to abstain from votes, he was willing to not be voted on. And they went through several rounds of deciding who they ended up coming to. They don't normally, correct me if I'm wrong, Carrie, but they don't normally pick someone other than ones that they have nominated. They stepped out on this one and actually went for Mr. Blanton, who came from Mr. Sanders. So that was very interesting to me that they didn't nominate one of their own nominees and vote for them. So I just wanted to throw that in there.
One other thought I had, if we were to pick
715 for Mr. Lucy and 715 for Mr. Tough. And that gives each of them 715 votes. If we gave 197 to Mr. Blanton, that gives him 715. That leaves us with 197 votes. And the county's other nominee was Mr. Casey. Mm-hmm. And if we gave our 197 votes to Mr. Casey, that would give him 716. And then we know the MUDs are going to elect Mr. Hoffheiser with 712. And so that would put them all right in the range where they fairly well would be elected.
Okay.
That's just a thought.
And I've worked with Mr. Hoffheiser before on the Alderbridge Village Association. He's a very good man. I really liked his approach to things.
But just,
I don't know who Casey is.
I don't either. And just to be honest, I mean, we don't.
We have
Hoffheiser is going to be in there whether we vote on him or not. I mean,
right.
We don't have. He has the vote, so that's always been true of the MUDs.
I think we have Casey's bio.
I don't know him and don't have anything for him or against him, but he's in. Period.
Right. Right.
Mr. Casey's is page two.
Page two. Thank you.
So what we don't want to do, the suggestion is not to do a block vote, correct?
Well, we can do individual.
We can do whatever we want. Yeah,
sure. I know in the past we've done a block vote. In 2015, I'm pretty sure we did a block vote.
We did.
If we don't want to do that this time, then.
I was the one that I think brought that up, and the only reason I know is that Mrs. Bush has a conflict with Mr. Blanton, and she's not going to be able to vote for the helm.
Okay.
And I don't feel like it's
business relationship.
There's a business relationship there, and I want her to be able to vote for the others.
I'm fine if we do a block vote, and I will abstain. It's whatever.
Well, how about
we
this? Are we at a point where we can start making some motions?
Sure. Yes.
I'll be glad to make a motion. I move that we take our 1,739 votes and cast them 715 for Mr. Lucy, 715 for Mr. Tough.
I thought we weren't doing a block vote.
I'm fine with abstaining completely, so we.
You want to do one at a time? Okay.
I think he needs to finish his.
Let us finish his motion.
If he gets a second,
finish the motion. Yes, we can.
Then we can amend
go
it
forward.
If we need to.
Yes.
So 715 for Mr. Lucy, 715 for Mr. Tough, 197 for Mr. Blanton, and 197 for Mr. Casey.
Okay.
You
need a second before we start.
Yeah. Do we have a second?
Got a second.
All right, discussion. Mr. Huber.
I would rather not do the block vote personally. I'd like just to go ahead and move forward because I don't feel appropriate to vote for to block vote. I like all these suggestions, but I don't know Bob Casey. I would like to withhold on voting on someone that I don't know.
I'm willing to withdraw my motion.
Okay. All right.
I don't know if I need to.
I'd like to make. Move that we approve 715 votes for Mr. Lucy and 715 for Mr. Tough. How about that?
All right. Do we have a second for those two?
How about
715 for Mr. Lucy?
Okay.
Call it a day.
Let's do one motion. We have a motion for Mr. Lucy, 715.
Second.
Mr. Williams, second. Any discussion on this? All right. All those in favor?
All right.
I have a motion.
All right.
I'd like to move that we cast, I believe it's 197, check my math.
Yes.
Votes for Barry Blanton.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Abstention? All right. Next motion.
I'd like, go ahead.
I'd move we cast 715 for Mr. Tough.
Second.
All right. We have a motion and a second for 715 for Mr. Tough. Discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor? Opposed? Motion passes.
How many we got left?
197.
Right.
Now, I mean, you know, who knows Bob Casey? Anybody?
No.
I don't know.
Okay. Neither do I.
What do you recommend?
Well, rather than cast votes for somebody that none of us know, I'd suggest that we break the 197 down equally to give each one of those 715 more votes, but not just cast votes for somebody just because we have them to cast.
Second. Is that a motion?
It is. And I don't know the math work with
it. Well, hold on. We're gonna have to break that down a little
wait
further.
Wait a minute. How many is left?
197.
No.
Can we do the math again so we know exactly what's left?
Yeah.
The first motion was for how many?
715.
And second motion was for?
197.
197.
Okay. And 715 again.
1627?
It's 112.
1627.
Subtracted from 1739.
There's some mathematicians here, boy.
We 112 can get it figured is out. What's left.
112.
So 112. I suggest 25 and 3 is 28 votes apiece for the four people that we've cast votes for.
Second.
Or added to the. Is that okay?
It is. I'm just trying to think how poor Linda's going to write this.
We're going to have to go back and amend the motions that we just voted on.
Okay, motion to amend and then we cast a new slate. New slate being what's the numbers for each candidate?
Okay. I suggest we cast 715 and 28. Check my math. 743.
Hold on.
He's right. Okay, 743.
197 and 28 is 5. Carry you 225 for Barry Blanton. Am I doing all right so far?
28 is not the right math on this in the first place, so let's stop.
What?
28 votes each does not get you to 112.
We understand that. We're going back into it.
Well, it's 29. 37 votes is actually with a third left for each person.
112 divided
Mr. Rush,
by 4?
You want to help him out?
By 3.
By 4.
Who's the fourth? We have Blanton, Lucy, and Tuff. Who's the fourth? We have 3.
Okay.
Now, let's pause a minute.
Yes.
Are we all in favor, and this is discussion, we are not making a motion at this moment, are we all in favor of splitting the remaining 112 votes between Lucy, Tuff, and Blanton?
Yes.
Why don't you have someone, if somebody wants to make that motion.
Okay. Would someone like to make the motion that we split it? We can discuss how we allocate
it. So moved.
I have it.
Okay. So moved. Second?
Second.
All right.
Okay, so.
Now, discussion.
What is the motion?
It's 754 votes for two of them and 700 and.
No, it's.
And 236 for the other.
So my question is, in order to pull this off, I'm not sure that we should go back and amend a motion that's already been seconded and discussed and voted on.
I
think the proper way to do it would be to make a motion to say the remaining votes get cast between and list out the people.
Agreed.
Yes. Doing it.
So
I believe.
Hold on. We have a motion on the table.
You can remove the motion.
Right. And so I would you like to withdraw your motion to
he
split
didn't make
it into?
Motion.
I don't think I made it. Did I?
No.
Oh, Mr. Williams.
Okay, I withdraw my motion. I'm lost where I am on the motion front.
I'd like to move, Madam President, that we
allocate
39 votes to the following three people. 39 additional votes.
That's too much.
Not 39.
It's 37 to two of them and 38 to one of them. So we need to decide who's getting 38.
Eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Okay, I think Barry's younger than the other two, so let's give him 38. No, whatever.
Okay.
That's fine. 38 to
37 for Mr. Lucy and 37 for Mr. Tuff. Is that okay?
Got a second.
That's
a good
motion.
Got your math calculator work?
Yeah,
that
works.
That is correct.
That works.
Second. Mr. Williams, did I hear you second that?
I'm good with that. I think we're
okay. Mr. Williams seconded that. Any further discussion on this?
No, I think.
Thank you.
Better.
All right. All those in favor?
Is it left hand or right hand? I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, I'm ready to vote.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? Abstention.
All right. Let's get it. Good job.
All right.
Good job, bro.
I think that may have been the hardest job of my presence.
So,
yeah. All right, item 9B. We have a specific motion that needs to be read on this. This is
me.
Yes, Mr. Williams.
Madam President, I move that the board propose suspending the term contract employee Ronnie Holt without pay for the remainder of the 2017-2018 school year for good cause and authorize the superintendent to provide Mr. Holt notice of this action.
I second the motion.
All right. All those in favor? Motion passes. Item 9C.
Madam President, I move that the board propose suspending the term contract employee Robert Beasy without pay for the remainder of the 2017-2018 school year for good cause and authorize the superintendent to provide Mr. Beasy notice of this action.
I second.
All right. Motion and a second. All those in favor? Motion passes. With that, we will adjourn to executive session. It is 7:30.
Bush, would you back on the record and read the closed session language?
Yes.